test.
I sure.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Hope you're excited to be in the house today. Have a full packed day today, so let's make sure that we're flowing and going in order, expecting God to move, to have his way. We'll have the kids today coming up. We'll have our communion. So as we worship and praise and get into the atmosphere of giving him glory and honor that is due his name, he is so worthy to be praised, so worthy to be glorified, so worthy to be honored. So as we open up, we welcome you all here. We welcome those that are part of Fountain of Life that are here in the building. We welcome those that are watching on our YouTube and our Facebook channel. We thank you for all of you joining in, and we ask that you allow God to move and have his way today, to move by his spirit. As we go into praise and worship, God, we need you more and more to have your way in this place, in this house. We want you more than anything. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory,
glory.
Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Friends don't treat me like they used to. Since I laid my burdens down. Yeah, come on. Friends don't treat me like they used to. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. They say it like this. Say it. Burdens down, Lord. Burdens down, Lord. Since I laid my burdens down. Your burdens down, Lord. Your burdens down, Lord. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Since I laid my burdens down. Hallelujah. We have to give it to him. Hallelujah. Lay it on him. His yoke is easy. Hallelujah. Burdens down, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. Come on and give him glory. Come on, put your hands together. We're going to praise him because he's worthy of praise, worthy of glory, worthy of honor. Hallelujah, Lord. We magnify you. We glorify you. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Children of Israel.
Timing, oh God. Hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah. You're worthy, Lord God. Thank you, Lord. You're on time. Hallelujah. You're worthy, oh God. So excellent, oh God. There's none like you, Lord Jesus. We give you all praise and glory, oh God, that is due your name. Hallelujah, Lord God. Thank you, Lord, for all that you are, for who you are, Lord God. We magnify you. We glorify you, Lord God. Hallelujah. You are, oh God.
Lord, yes, yes,
Thank you, Father. there's none like you, Lord God. None like you, oh God. You're so excellent. You lead us. You guide us, God. You direct our paths. Hallelujah, Lord God. Oh, you order our steps. We won't go without you, Lord. We don't want to take one step without you, Lord. Hallelujah. We want to go when you go, where you go, how you go. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Yes,
Lord. Order my steps in your word, Lord. Lead me, guide me every day. In your anointing, Father, I pray. Order my steps in your word. Please.
Please order my steps in your word.
Yes, God.
Please order.
your word. Show me how to talk in your word. Provide me a brand new
song to sing.
Show me how to let your praises ring in your word. In your word.
Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word.
Yes, God.
Please order my steps in your word. Please order my steps in your word.
Just need the Lord to order our steps. As we continue in worship, I just ask that you stand as we prepare to go into our Holy Communion. Still part of worship. The Word of the Lord tells us as often as we do this, that we do this in remembrance of Him. We remember the birth, the life, the death and the resurrection of Jesus. And when we partake of this Holy Communion, we're remembering that. The miraculous birth. The sin-free life that Jesus lived. The death where the grave could not contain him. And so the resurrection. We remember those things because he did it for us, for you, for me, for our sins. So when we partake of this Holy Communion, it's all about him. It's not about the wine that's symbolic of the juice or the wafer that's symbolic of the body. It's about remembering what Jesus did and how Jesus was. When he was with his disciples and what they call the Last Supper, Jesus broke bread with them and gave them walking words. Let us pray. Father, as we come before you today, we lift this before you this day. The juice, which represents the blood. The wafer, which represents the body. We ask that you bless this, Lord God, as we partake of this. Your word says, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. And today we remember that. Remembering that Jesus was that sacrifice to be that bridge for us. While we were yet in the midst of sin, Jesus found a way to bring us back to you, Lord. And it was through his death. And we thank you that we can be and we can have this union with you. We thank you that we're restored and we have this free gift of salvation. And we thank you that we can come and remember that day. Not just remember, but celebrate. And as we celebrate, we can rejoice because we are one in Christ with you. So for all those that partake, Father, I ask that you bless us and be with us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. So as we partake, of this Holy Communion. For those that have accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, for those that have accepted Jesus, we ask that you join us to participate in. For those that are coming in, if you want to come as we partake, as Jesus was with the disciples, he was teaching them how to be one, how to be unified. Starting on my right, your left. The word of the Lord says in 1 Corinthians 11:27. So then whoever eats the bread or drink the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. And because of that, we have this opportunity where we come and we can pray and seek the face of God. If there's any unrepentant sin in our hearts, then we can go before him as we pray, asking that he forgive us. It's our desire to be and live according to the Bible, to walk according to his ways and his will. And so we take this opportunity to examine ourselves. As scripture says in the 28th verse, everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat the bread and drink of the cup. Whoever eats and drinks without discerning the body of Christ eats and drinks judgment upon themselves. And so this opportunity is for you and for me. It's not for me to call out you or you to call on anyone else. It's for you to examine yourself. You know where your walk is with the Lord. You know where your relationship is with the Lord. And if it's not where it needs to be, then this is an opportunity that we have to go before the Lord in prayer before we even partake of this Holy Communion. This gives us that great opportunity to see. Ask the Holy Spirit to show him, to show you what he sees. It's all about our relationship. Your relationship with him, my relationship with him. And where it is, this gives us an opportunity to evaluate that or to examine that. And if you find that your relationship is not the way it should be in your walk with Christ, then this is an opportunity for you now to seek the face of God and ask, can he change that? For you to spend more time in prayer, for you to spend more time in his word, so that you too can partake of this relationship that God has called us. As we partake in this, it's all about him. When you think about this, this is one time we ask that you be selfish. It's about you and a him. You thinking about you and your walk. The word says, for those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eats and drinks judgment upon himself. How do we discern the body of Christ? It's through our walk, through our relationship. Every day may not have been the way we want it, but every day we have an opportunity to go back and be closer. Let us pray. Father, as we come before you this day, Lord God, in preparation of partaking in this Holy Communion, we thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for prompting us. And we thank you, Father God, for offering this free gift of salvation through Jesus. And we come, Lord God, if we have any unrepentant sin in our lives, we come before you right now. Father, if we have an ought with our brother, we come to you right now, Father. And we thank you that we can come to you, Lord God, and pray and ask for forgiveness and walk this way. As we come, Father, we surrender our will and our ways because it's all about you. Our relationship is so important. As we grow in it day by day, we look to you. And as the songwriter says, order our steps. That's what we look from you, for you, Lord God, this day, that you order our steps. And as we surrender, Lord God, we hope that it's you guiding us and leading us in ordering our steps each day. Father, we give you all the glory and all the praise. The word of the Lord says, for I received from the Lord and I passed on from you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Take and eat. After supper, in the same manner, he took the blood of the new covenant and says, this is the blood of the new covenant, which is for you. Take and drink. Father, as we've partaken in this Holy Communion, we ask that you bless us, be with us, guide us, and strengthen us. And we thank you as I lift each soul to you today. You speak to us and guide us. Show us what you see. As you order our steps, we look to you, giving you glory and praise. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. If you would, if you prepare, if you just embrace yourself for our kids, if they go through this portion of the Black History Month, everybody knows this is a lot. I love this portion of the year in terms of when we go back to old songs and remembering the days of way back when. Black History Month is something that we come to celebrate, and we will. In this month, as our kids go through what they have for us today.
Black History Month is a very important month. It's a time where we remember, but it's not just the only month we do it. It's a small history in it. Black history was only started to be celebrated back in the 1970s. It started off earlier, a little before that they did a week of it. Then they moved forward to a month of it for what we have today. But a lot of times, if we don't remember where we've come from, we have a lot of tendency of repeating those things. And if we don't remember the good things, we don't know how and where we've come from to duplicate those things. So as we go into Black History today, we're going to put forward today, and there's many people. We talk a lot about some of the known people that they are, but we're going to have a few less known people today so we can learn of some people that have made some big contributions to history, has changed a lot of things, has done a lot of things for the Black people and for Black history. And as we see these people and meet these people, we'll learn a lot about them and know the contribution that they have given. So as you listen today, I hope that you take it in and that you learn more. As the kids has worked a lot on these, their speeches and their things. But as we learn who they are, I want you to listen to it and hear what they're saying. We have one coming now.
I am Alice H. Parker in 1895 through 1920. I am an African-American inventor. I am Alice H. Parker in 1895 through 1920s. I am an African-American inventor who was active in the early 1900s. I am most widely recognized for my passion field gas furnace, which is served for the development of the modern heating system in today's use.
Thank you, Alice Parker. Thank you very much, Alice Parker. Here's another one coming now. Who are you?
Hi, I'm Bessie Coleman. I was born and raised in a poor family in a time of discrimination and segregation, but this didn't stop me to become the first Black woman to become a licensed pilot. My love for aviation was from stories of returning World War soldiers. I sadly, tragically died in a plane crash in 1926 at the young age of 34. I am still remembered as a courageous trailblazer and a role model for Black pilots today.
Betsy Coleman. Here we have another one.
I'm Shirley Jackson, and I'm a pioneering physicist and the first African American woman to earn a PhD from the Massachusetts Institute, MIT. My research is theoretical and physics.
All right, Shirley.
Thank you. I'm Shirley Cheesel. My birthday is November 30th, 1924. I am an American politician. I am the first Black woman to be elected to the United States Congress. I am the first Black woman to run from the Democratic Party. I am a strong believer in civil rights and women's rights.
Hi, my name is Jane Boland. I graduated from Wesley College in 1928 as the top of my class, and I went to go continue my law degree. Although I didn't have much support, I still went to make American history. As I grew through the ranks, I got accepted into Yale College, and I was the first Black woman to get my law degree from there.
I am James McCoon Smith. I was born on April 13, 1813, in Manhattan, New York. I was the first African American to receive a medical degree. I graduated at the top of my class at the University of Glasgow, Scotland. I was the first African American to run a pharmacy in the U.S. I'm a member of the American Anti-Slavery Society with Frederick Douglass. I started the National Council of Colored People in 1853, which was the first permanent national organization for Blacks.
I am George Edwin Taylor. I was born August 4th, 1857. I was the first African-American to run for president. I was also in 1904, I was the candidate for the National Negro Liberty Party for the President of the United States. I died December 23rd, 1925 at the age of 68.
So as I said, there's been a lot of contribution that has been done, more than just our Martin Luther King's and Malcolm X. We thank our kids for the work that they put in. I know that they studied a lot to get ready for today and to remember their things. And we thank you all for all the efforts put in and Sister Jordan and Miss Kendall and Sister Kendall that put in the time and working with you guys. Good job. Thank you.
Well, come on, give back here some glory, a little bit more glory today. Thank you, everybody, for being a part of that. You know, when we talk about Black history, it's often, you know, sometimes we have some good teachers out there that try to expose our kids to some a different name or a different person in terms of that. But then we have some lazy teachers that go with the traditional, you know, Martin Luther King. But it's great because over the last couple of years, you've seen even they've come out with some of the ones that I've talked about over the years, because there's so many great Americans. People don't really realize that so many great Blacks that have invented so many things. Like, it was a Black woman that invented all the technology for cell phones, and then we have the heater systems, and we have so many Black Americans that have such great contribution to today's society and where it is today. The world won't tell you, and people won't tell you, but there's so much of our Black history that we don't even know, that people refuse to get out. And that's why Black History Month is so important to me, as we continue to share and embrace these things. So many of you probably didn't know that there was the first Black man, which was in 1918, a presidential candidate. Everybody sit back and think about Barack Obama. But there were so many greats way before him that paved the way so that he can even be a candidate to be successful and become a president. So many paved the way for what we are always able to achieve today. And we have to always give homage to our Black history heroes. Amen. Amen. So as we prepare to go into Word today, I'm always grateful. So thankful again for our kids, Sister Jordan, Sister Kendall, and even the parents for getting them whatever they need to. This year, again, we're really putting an emphasis on our kids in certain things. With the limited few kids that we do have, we're being creative in some of the things that we will do. We're already preparing for our Resurrection Sunday. Now we're moving forward to Resurrection, and we want your child to be involved in that as well. So if you will, we're starting that already, because we want our kids to know and understand some of these things, and this is how we do it. So if you stand to your feet as we prepare to go into Word this day. Hallelujah. Father, as we come before you today, we come in the name of Jesus, thanking you for this great opportunity. Father, open our hearts, our minds to receive from you today. Your word, Lord God, is sharper than a two-edged sword, and we look for it to come in and pierce, Lord God, all of those things and cut out unrighteousness so that you can fill it today as your word goes forward. Father, we give you honor and glory today, and it's in your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 As we move forward, as we're talking about this process of staying in your lane, you know, it's so much as we move forward into this, so many aspects of staying in your lane that we're going to go in. Today we're going to go down, continue down an avenue where there are many lanes that God has called us to be in. And as Christians, we so often get out that lane. If you can think about your drive this morning as you were coming in, how many of you swerved in the other lane or was in the other lane for a split second, wasn't focusing? And that's how we are as born-again believers. Sometimes we're in the wrong lane, or we swerve through, and we're not in the lane that God has assigned for us. And as born-again believers, that's what this series is this year as we move forward, is making sure we are aligned to where God has called us and we're in the lane so that we can accomplish all that God has called us to accomplish, to fulfill all that he's called us to fulfill and move forward. Our cortex. Hey, can you turn the monitors down, please? Our cortex coming out of Matthew 7:13. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is easiest to travel, is the path that leads to the way of destruction and eternal loss, and there are many who enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow and difficult to travel is the path that leads the way to everlasting life, and there are few who find it. Now we begin to look at this, and Jesus, and I break it down a little bit more this time, and I've gone as we prepare the series, and we begin to look through this. There are two roads. There's the broad road, which I call the wrong road, and there's the road that many people go down. When we look at this, Jesus was talking, and he was talking to his disciples, and he was letting them know that in life, you know, we can split it up no matter how we want, but there are only two roads to go in this life. There's the broad road or the wrong road, and then there's the right road or the narrow road. And when we begin looking at this, you have to ask yourself, and we're not going to spend a whole lot of time on the broad road, but we look at this. That broad road is crowded. And sometimes we find ourselves on that road, and sometimes we're, and you, some of us may be even on that road today because, you know, sometimes in life it's easy to drift and it's easy to walk away when we lose focus. But Proverbs 16:25 says, there is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end is the way of death. I look at that because I want to show you this, and I want to show you this in a different, let's look at the broad road or the wide road. This road here, when we go to it, if you go to the next slide, is the road of conformity. A lot of times this road here, we conform. The Bible tells us in Romans 12 to conform, not to conform to the pattern of the ways of the world. But a lot of times when we find, we was kind of going into it this morning in our men's Bible class, and in terms of, it's so easy as born-again believers to get in and be on the wrong road sometimes. And sometimes we get on that road and don't even recognize we're on that road. But this series is aligned to help us to understand we have a road and we have a lane that God has called us to, and he wants us to be there. But then there's this road of conformity where we start conforming. Because, you know, right now I can start naming or saying some cliches, and we think are Christian cliches, and they're just myth. It's nowhere in the Bible. Why? Because people have adopted some things and have gone into it. And just like in the days of today in the world, we start conforming to some. We start just going through and going. Why? Because the world does it and the world accepts it. And so it tells us, even in today's society, that we should accept it. But as born again believers, we are called to this place. We're called to this narrow road. But sometimes we gravitate to right now. If there was a crowd outside, And we were outside and they saw smoke from a barbecue pit, people will start coming over because they see a crowd. And that's the way it is with our nature. Sometimes we start gravitating to things. And as born-again believers, we got to understand that that's not what God has called us. That's the wide road. That's the crowded road. That's the road of conformity where we begin to conform to the ways of the world and start doing things. You see it today. You can see a pastor now. And you know, when I said this, you can see how we try to mimic some of the ways of the world and do some of those things. That's the road of conformity. How many of us have gone on that road? I've been there at a time, but I allow the Holy Spirit to show me, to guide me, to lead me. We got to understand when we start looking at these roads, then there's the road of, this the road, this is my life. You know, you have people now that will tell you, and they're on this particular road. And they're on this road, and they're saying that it's my life. You know, I can do, and I can do, and I can do because it's my life. You know, and I have the ability to do what I want. We have those that's on the road of I can get away with it. You know, we're always good with it until we get caught. But I can get away with it. I can get away with it. So many roads in our lives in this Christian walk. And there's so many roads that leads us off. And sometimes we get on those roads. Well, and when that happens, we got to recognize, as the Holy Spirit begin to tell us, that we made the wrong turn, that we need to get off that road to get back on anew, because there's so many distractions in the world today that leads us. Then there's the road to the roads of lies, where we live with lies, or the roads to deceit, where we live with deceit. We have to understand that this is the road that the Bible called the broad road, the wide road. The road of conformity, the road, but that's not where God has called us. We got to look at this narrow road. The Bible tells us in Acts 2:14, when you start thinking about that, if you start thinking about your life today, even as a born-again believer, and you understand that there's two roads, there's really two roads and only two roads, the wide road, the right road, the wide road, the wrong road, or the narrow road, the right road. And we can even look at Moses' life. Most of us know that Moses was chosen by God to lead the people to the promised land. But you guess what happened to Moses at the end? Moses never got to the promised land. Why? Because Moses got on the wrong road. Because you can see his life of being led by the Spirit of God as the Israelites traveled for many, many years. You can think about it, but most times we don't think about Moses not making it to the promised land. All we see is the greatness of Moses and what Moses was able to do when he was on the right road. But even Moses got on the wrong road and didn't even make it to the promised land. And as our Christian lives, we can look at ourselves and think, man, am I on the wrong road? Are we constantly thinking about the wrong road? Then there's the right road. Well, the Bible tells us in Matthew 2:14, the right road, when Jesus was passing by, he called Matthew. Jesus said to him, he says, follow me as my disciples, accepting me as your master and teaching and walking the same path of life that I walk. And that scripture began to show us and tell us that there's one road for born-again believers, and that's the path where we're following Jesus, as he told Matthew. And so we have to look at our lives and analyze our lives. No matter what we're doing or where we're going, if you're ever questioning what road that you're on, you got to ask yourself, am I following Jesus? Is Jesus right ahead? And see, most of the time we're looking for someone else to tell us, or we're trying to dodge that. But we have to ask ourselves as born-again believers, as scripture was saying in 1 Corinthians 11, we talked about it. We have to get into a place where we're examining our lives so that we're constantly making sure that we're on the right road. If you're ever traveling, how many people have traveled a long distance? If you're ever traveling a long distance and you're constantly looking at your GPS, making sure you're on the right road. You're constantly making sure because you don't want to get on the wrong road and go into the wrong place, or you want to get to that place that you're going in a fast time. And so you're constantly, truck drivers, we got several truck drivers in here. I'm sure that they're constantly looking at their GPS, trying to make sure that they're on the right road. And as we move down this series, I'm hoping that you're constantly examining yourselves and, Lord, am I on? I was up there the other day as I was meditating. Am I on the right road in some things that I was going on and some things that I'm doing? It's a constant process that we must go through as we begin looking at this, because that narrow road sometimes looks lonely. Remember, it's not the crowded road, but it's that road where not a lot of people are. And sometimes we feel lonely on that road. But we're not lonely because God is with us on that particular road. We're not lonely because we have the Spirit of God with us on that road. We're not lonely because we have Jesus with us on that road. But so often, because we don't see other people, because we don't see other things, we don't see other people doing other things, we feel like we're on that road alone. But this, as we go through this series, I'm challenging you to examine yourself, to making sure, am I following the same path as Jesus? Oh, no, don't worry about following the path of me. Don't worry about following the path of Minister Tracy, Minister Isaac, Minister Jeff. Worry about, are you following the path of Jesus? Because I can get on the wrong road. We all happen to get on the wrong road sometimes. It's important that we're on this narrow road and we're following the path that Jesus has. Because if you follow man, man will lead you into the wrong place. Man will lead you to the wrong place. Often, even I just spoke about, Moses was leading them. He was supposed to lead them to the promised land, but he didn't even make it, because sometimes we get on that wrong road. You have to ask yourself, am I following the path of Jesus? Is Jesus the one that's calling us? Is Jesus the one that we're looking to? Is Jesus the one that we have to be there? And we have to ask that question. All this, am I following the path of Jesus? So, let's get on that road. The first road that we're getting there, we're talking about, is a one-way road. Everybody has been on one-way road, where you can get on the road, and the only way you can go is straight. There's no cars coming at you. You're on that. If you're not familiar with that, drive downtown, get down to 24th Street, 25th Street. Those are one-way roads now. And when you get down there, you can only go one. Now, you can get on that road and go the wrong way, but you're bound to get hit. You're bound to get hurt. You're bound to get a ticket. You're bound to get in an accident because you're going literally the wrong way. So God has called us to this road, and it's a one-way road, and there's nothing about it. We get on this road, and he wants us to go full speed ahead on this road and not look back. He wants us to make sure that when we're on this road that we're doing what he's called us to do and how he's called us to do it. But many Christians miss this road. As we're driving along, sometimes you miss a turn, and you have to turn back and go to it. Sometimes many born-again believers, we miss this turn, whether it was accidental or it was on purpose. We missed this one. This particular road that we're talking about is a one-way street, and it's called seeking the lost. And God has called every single born-again believer to go down this road. But it seems like we're in a time now where we have to get more aggressive with this, because there are more and more people that are not seeking the face of God. They're not seeing the face of God. There's more and more people. And I think God is calling us, and that we got to get back in the car. It's not just that we're on the wrong road. I think some Christians have gotten out of the car and turned it off. And because we've gotten out of the car and turned it off, then there's no way for us to be driving down the road that God has called us to. And guess what? Because we're not driving down that road, we can't pick up who God has called us to pick up along the way. Now, down this road, this is a road that many born-again believers, and I'm talking all throughout the local church or the universal church, this is one of those roads. It's a one-way road, but we do a very bad job at it. Even scripture began to tell us that we're doing a bad job in it. But here at Fountain Life, I want to make sure that we're doing our job, driving down this right road, doing exactly what God has called us, because it's important today, and I'll show you some of the importance today. Scripture began to tell us in Matthew 28:19, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We got to understand that in today's society, there are more broken people than ever before. There are more hurting people than ever before. There are more struggling people than ever before. Black, white, Chinese, Japanese, any kind of knees, all them knees, it doesn't matter. There are more than ever before, and that's why we all need to be in our car. Some of us, instead of trying to arrive with somebody, we need to get in our own car and drive down this road. This is a trip for you to take by yourself. God wants you. We must be seeking the lost, especially in these times today. God is calling us to it. And it's so important that we get to it. The Bible begins to tell the very first thing we see here, that Jesus begins telling them, I'm leaving you guys, so let me leave some parting words with you. The parting words that I'm going to leave with you today is that I need you to baptize and make disciples. But in order for you to baptize and make disciples, the very first thing you got to do is you got to identify those that are lost. And here at Final Life, that's one of our priorities. That's part of our vision. That's part of our mission statement. We must be out here. That's part of the vision for this year, that we must be out here seeking the lost more than ever before. You know, so often people think it's the pastor's job or the minister's job or the leader's job. It's the church job to seek the lost. Why? Because let me tell you, you got some lost at work. You got some lost at school. You got some lost in your family. There's some lost everywhere you look behind. You got some lost that you talk and chit-chat with every day at the grocery store or Walmart or wherever it is that you shop. Some of y'all, if y'all like me, y'all go probably to the same. I'm one of those that I like to do the same thing. I'm just that way. I like to eat the same thing. I like to go to the same place. So people see me, and I begin seeing people and knowing people because I go to the same place and I eat the same thing and know to do that. When I go to the gas station, I can talk to the person. I can wave up. Hey, what's up, Dave? Because they say, hey, Dave, back again. And so y'all have some of the same things where y'all go and do. And so because of that, y'all are talking to people right now who are lost. Y'all talking to people who are hurt, and you can't see their hurt because it's within them. We got to understand. You have a story to tell. Everybody in here today, and as I look around, I presume everybody in here, because I've talked with you, have accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. And I presume everybody in here, but about one or two, have accepted Jesus that I know have accepted. And because you've accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, guess what you got? That's every single one of us got a story. But guess what? Your story is different than my story. Your story is more impactful to whoever God has called you to witness to than my story. Because guess what? What you did and I did are two totally different things. That's why I told you when we're all on the same line, we're all on a track running. But we're not running against each other. We're running with each other. We're in different lanes, but we're running. We're not like in the world's way when you're on a track, you're running against somebody. In God's way, when you're on a track, you're running with somebody. And so I'm running with you. We're in a different lane. Why? Because what I have to share and what you have to share is different. But we're still running together. And God is calling us to share our story. Everybody has a story. Everybody has a story to be a witness to somebody. And on this one-way road, God is not asking that you ride with somebody. He's asking that you get out because he's giving you your own car to drive down this road. And so while you're driving down this road, it's time for you to start making some of these stops that God has called along the way. You know, when y'all got ready to come to church this morning, some of y'all made some stops before y'all got here, didn't you? And that's how this is on this road. Sometimes there's some stops. Why? Because you got to pick up somebody on the way. You got to pick up somebody who is lost. You got to support somebody who is lost, and this is what God is calling us. Mark 16:15 says, and he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. He was not just talking to his disciples, because he left these parting words for us, that he wants us to go into all the nation. He wants us to go. This one-way street, Luke 15:7, just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need. He begins to break it down and help us understand. Guys, you know what? I want you on this one-way road, and I want you sharing your story. I want you sharing the gospel with these people. And then he comes back and he says, and when one person, think about this as a minute, that the Lord can look down in here right now and see 50 people in here, And as he's looking at 50 people, he's grateful that we're here and we're praising him and honoring him, but he's not celebrating us. But if one person walks through that door, not only is God tickled today that they're coming in and that they were lost and they're accepting Jesus or repenting of their sin, they're turning away from the worldliness and turning to him, that he and heaven celebrates with him. Think about that for just a minute. When we're going through and we're singing and we're praising, man, I can see the angels probably singing and praising along with us. But the Bible tells us right here that there's a stoppage in something, that something else happens when one person accepts Jesus as Lord and Savior. When one person turns his life from the world to the Word, when one person turns to Jesus, we begin looking at Scripture and he says this, that they're celebrating. So all of heaven is celebrating. We should be celebrating. That's important. We got to understand the importance when Scripture begins to show us this, how important it is that somebody changes. I can show you in Scripture in another way. The importance of witnessing. Look at Luke 15. We begin looking at this, and we see this in so many words. In the same way, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents, that is, changes his inner self, his old way of thinking, regrets past sins, live his life in a way that proves repentance and seeks God's purpose for his life. See, all of these things and what they did is what we should be teaching. And what they did is what we should be showing. And what they did is this the road that we should be driving down so that we can help someone else. Somebody was there to help me. Somebody was there to help you. Somebody was driving down that road of seeking the lost for you, whether it was just praying for you. See, we always think that the only way we can do it is just go out. It's not the only way. That's one way that he wants us to do it. But another way is to pray. We got to understand, we got to be praying for the lost. Lord, there are some out there that are lost that I'm going to pass by tomorrow. Give me words to speak to them that would encourage them to turn and look to you. I mean, it's so much that we could be praying every day. When we talk about prayer, there's so much to pray. And one of the things that we can be praying is, how do we seek the lost? Lord, you give me the words to say. Forget about your own words. You ain't got to be nervous, because God will give you the words to say. And sometimes the words is just, I understand, I'm just going to listen. Sometimes we don't have to say nothing. They just need somebody who care, who showed enough to care. Think about it. Before you accept Jesus, Lord and Savior, you was out in the world. And somebody was praying for you, or somebody was there to seek you out. Somebody was there for you. So why should we be any different? And I'm showing you through Scripture how the Bible says that God is celebrating when somebody changes their life or turns their life around. If that's important to God, it should be important to us. If he is celebrating it, why shouldn't we be celebrating it? Again, we're following the path, right? We're on this road of following Jesus. And if we're following Jesus and we're following what he do, this is what he did. Scripture began to tell us the importance of witnessing. Why do we witness? Because Jesus tells us to. I mean, that enough should be alone, but it's not. But that enough should be alone. If you can think about some of the people in your family right now who are not saved, or who you think are not saved, because we got people in our family who are saved, but they just don't live like it. But so you may have some in your family who are saved or who are not saved. Are you praying for them? What are you doing? How are you doing it? I stopped and think about this, and we have to think about this. Luke 15:10, everybody knows this scripture. Everybody has heard of the prodigal son. Let's just go down there for just a little bit. I want to show you a little bit of something, because this is about what we're talking about. Then he said, a certain man, Jesus was talking. And, you know, Jesus was teaching them parables, and he started teaching them. He says, then Jesus said to him, he says, a certain man had two sons. The younger of them, inappropriately, said to the father, Father, give me the shares of the property that falls to me. So he divided the estate between the two. A few days later, the younger son gathered together everything that he had and traveled to a distant country, and there he wasted his fortunes in reckless and immoral living. So father had two sons, and Jesus was giving this parable, trying to teach it, and he was just trying to teach that there was two types of people. There was one that was believers, and there was one that was unbelievers. Or there was one that was believers, and there was one that had backslidden, however you want to put it. Either way, they weren't in God's grace at this moment. And that's what he was showing them right now. He begins to go on in the 21st verse, and he said to the son to him, Father, the son came. He says, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to the servants, quickly bring me the best robe for the guest of honor and put it on him and give him a ring for his hand and sandals for his feet. So now we took this unbeliever, or even the one that needs to be restored, however we want to put it. Two sons, one that's in the presence of God, one that's out of the presence of God. One that's living a moral life before the Lord, one that's living their moral life before the Lord. Whether they've never been saved or they were saved and been restored, it doesn't even really matter. Doesn't even really matter. All that matters is they're not in the presence of God. And Jesus began to use this analogy, and he's using this analogy. And then we have to understand it, because he comes back and he said, the son comes and he says, Father, I'm not even worthy. And he comes back to repent. And look at what the father said when he said this. Quickly, bring me out the best robe for the guest of honor and put it on him. Give him a ring for his hand, sandals for his feet. Bring the fattened calf and slaughter, and let us invite everyone and feast and celebrate. I mean, I'm just showing you this, how important it is. Seeking the lost is important because it was important for God. It's important because even Jesus began to show us. We see now in three different scriptures that they celebrated when one accepted Jesus, Lord and Savior. Here it is. The church today, we sit back and go, well, at least he ain't going to steal no more. We still talking about what he did. Jesus celebrating, or the heaven is celebrating that he ain't doing it no more. We still talking about what he did. Well, maybe he won't cheat on his wife no more. Oh, maybe he won't hurt. I mean, we just going on out there. And Jesus is there going, he's not even remembering what we did. He's not even concerned about what he did. What he's concerned about is that he has crossed over from heaven to hell. We don't sit and think about that a lot. We don't want to talk about that as much. But he has crossed over. Let me come a little closer to home for you. Let me tell you about it like this. Can you mute switcher for just a moment? Shut it down for just a second. It is so important that God is saying that in his word that they're celebrating. The angels are celebrating. Heaven is celebrating like having a party because somebody accepted Jesus, Lord and Savior. So when we're doing this, I'm sitting there thinking about this. I'm sitting there going that we don't need to have that conversation that we used to have years ago. Man, if you ain't accept Jesus, you're going to hell. Why would somebody want to? I mean, that's the first thing to push them away. Even though it may be real. I'm not saying deny scripture, but what I am saying doing is bring something to draw them to you. And telling them they're going to hell ain't drawing them. It's not. You know, it wouldn't draw me. You know? We as a body of Christ got to understand how seeking the lost has to be one of the most single important aspects of what we do. This is a road that he's called all us to go on when we begin looking. He says, bring the fattened calf and slaughter it, and let us invite everyone and feast and celebrate. For the son of mine was as good as dead. They was here in the physical, but spiritually I know they was gone, is what he was saying. Physically, because we see so much of the flesh, and we say, so we know, okay, he's good. Oh, he's good. But what the Father said? The Father said he was as good as dead. But guess what? Because now he's come back, he's accepted his free gift of salvation. He is alive again. He was lost, but now he's found. So they begin to what? Celebrate. We begin looking at this. People are lost, and here's the most important part of it. Dying without Christ. It's not so much that they're dying, because guess what? We're going to die, Ecclesiastes tells us in 7. He says, death is the destiny of every. We all going to die. I know we don't want to talk about it. We might as well get used to it. How can we get to heaven if we don't die? How can we get to? Death has got to be the situation that we got to learn to face and understand the reality of it. Yes, it hurts us when we lose a loved one. Oh, it's going to always hurt us. Why? Because we're not with them. Loss is always hard. Loss is always that part. Whatever kind of loss, there's a lot of different aspects of loss in this world. You know, I know a woman who lost her son to college. And you would have thought she lost him to the grave. So, I mean, loss is real. Whether it's through divorce or going off to another country or going, you know, it's real. But here's one that's real, too, that people are dying without Christ. So how much do we really love them if we're not going to talk to them and introduce? It's just our job to introduce them. The most beautiful thing about it was God was just showing us you don't have to beg, plead, or borrow for them to do nothing. All you have to do is just present it. And as born-again believers, we ain't driving down that street. Some of us right now, we down the street. We on that street, and we had a halt. We stopped, and ain't no stop sign. Why? Because we're afraid of what they may say. We're afraid. There's a lot of burials, and we'll get into that next week. There's a lot of things that's hindering us from witnessing. We have to learn how to overcome those barriers. We have to learn how to overcome those roadblocks because it's time now for us to invite Jesus into somebody's life. He is calling us. Scripture is telling us this is a road that he wants us to go down. It's the least traveled road, but it's one that he wants the most. It was a one-way road for a reason. It's a one-way road because he don't want nobody turning back. He wants us going down this street. He wants us continuing down this street, seeking the law, seeking everybody that we can. And if you're honest with yourself right now, you know you got a family member. You got a coworker. You got a close friend. Somebody you know that has not accepted Jesus, Lord and Savior. And you probably was just like me, just didn't want to mix that into that relationship. But God is saying, I don't want you to just mix it. I want it to be a part of every aspect of every relationship you have. Well, why should it be separate? It is who you are. I mean, just be who you are. That's the problem with us Christians. Sometimes we talk about other people. We have the biggest mask. We wear these masks all the time. We're a Christian for this and a Christian for that. But with this group, we just here. When God is saying, I just want you to be who you are. I want you to be who you are all the time, doing what I've called you to do. I have not called you to do anything to hurt anybody. I haven't called you to do anything to offend anybody that if with any righteous offense. I haven't called you to do anything to take anything from anybody. Everything that you're doing that you're going to be doing is going to help. Then why do we not want to help? We're the biggest ones. God is saying, Ecclesiastes says, death is the destiny of every man. We're going to die. And they are too. So why don't we do something about it? Why don't we help them get that insurance that they need? Why don't we help them get that preparation that is there? But we can't do it unless we're seeking the law. Scripture says in Psalms 34, the Lord is near to the heartbroken. He is ready for them. God is right. The scripture tells us that God does not want any man to perish. He don't want anybody to die without knowing Jesus. So guess he is there to help us in everything. You're not alone when you're seeking the lost. You're not. You're not alone. And if the church, here's one of the things. I love Fountain of Life. I love our family. I love how we do, how we pray. You know, when we find somebody out that's sick or something going on, we start praying, we'll go to a 24-hour prayer where we're praying for. We'll do whatever. But one of the things that I am disappointed that we don't do well is we don't seek the lost. I truly believe that if we sought the lost more, that more of these pews would be filled. It's not about numbers. Because some of the people that we seek ain't coming here. They're not. I know that, and you should know that. You shouldn't even get mad. When you're witnessing, you shouldn't even be thinking about Fountain of Life. You should just be thinking about life after death. Yeah, because God's going to send, but we got to do something for him to send. And that's one thing that I am, that I get so, that I be praying and I be so disappointed sometimes, is that we don't seek the lost like we should. We don't. Because we will see, the Bible tells us we're known, they're known by their what? Fruit. We're not producing fruit of seeking the lost. And we have to do a better job. Every single one of us. It's not on one, it's not on two, it's on every single one of us. And I'm not excluding myself, but guess what? I'm always inviting and having out. The crews and the people that I'm around, they're always being invited out. I somehow or another, I always slide it in. Yeah, a lot of people lie to me and say they're coming, and I get it. I understand. And if they're telling you that, I, you know, move on. I've gotten to a place, you know, I text. You know, some have stopped texting me back until they want something. Because I text them and say, hey, you want, and that just happened last week. And it's going to happen. But that's not our concern. I had said the other day, I got mad. I said, okay, I done text this guy four times, he'll text me back, except when I said, I'm going to pick you up for church. He won't text me back. And I said to myself, you know, I'm going to stop texting him. And God had to come to him and say, no, you ain't. We can't get discouraged, especially when it's not costing us a whole lot. They not rejecting me, they rejecting him. I mean, we got to get to that place, but we got to be seeking. And we're not seeking, and I say we because we're one. We're not seeking enough. We're not seeking enough. We are not seeking the lost enough. When we talk, it's so easy. And y'all know, when go to Dollar General, you're going to be in line for a minute. They ain't got but one person, half a person working. Oh, I say a half a person because that one working, but he's trying to play on his phone at the same time. So it's just a half going on right there. You know? You go to Walmart, they got 28 registers, but only the ones that says self-serve is open. So guess what? It's going to be a line over there. I mean, no matter where you go, you can have that conversation. You have to. God will give you every opportunity, and he gives me every opportunity. I can stir up a conversation about a bowl of cereal. I mean, if that's what that's where we're going. I'm serious. If you're on the cereal aisle, man, you know what? Man, the Lord had blessed me with some Captain Crunch. And he says, woo, glory. I'm telling you, you can just have the conversation of your life. I don't care where you are. Pastor, how am I going to do about on the tissue aisle? Just start telling them. Man, if God hadn't gave us tissue, what would we be doing? I mean, you know, it's just so you can take that conversation from a lot of different. You can just be creative with it. Just to be able to get, hey, Jesus. Hey, what's your, and I will. I'll be talking to somebody, and we'll be talking about, I was in O'Reilly's, I can remember about 2 months ago, and I was talking to a guy, and we was there, and we was talking about an alternator, and I said, what church you go to? How'd he get from alternator to church, homie? I just slid in there. Hey, what church? We having a conversation. I just thought I'd ask, you know? And so why are we? Where do you worship? You know? And I will. That's how I started. When I don't know somebody, that's one of the biggest ways I started. Hey, where you worship?
I mean, I just knew our spirits was connected. And I was just wondering, well, if you ain't. And so when they tell me, because I'm sitting there thinking sometimes when I'm seeking and I'm somewhere and they tell me what church they went to, sometimes you can hear, he said, that church. And so what I hear, I just play along with them. I said, well, man, if you ain't going there a lot, man, you can come to visit our church. I'm sitting there going, I help him understand that. I know that you ain't been there in a while, so let me give you my church address. Let me tell you. I mean, there are ways. God will show you. You open up. All you have to do is be willing. This is the one-way street that God has called us to when we begin looking at this. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted. We got to understand that he wants every person. We can't see some of these people that are broken. We can't see what's in their minds, in their hearts, their thoughts. We can't see. Sometimes when you speak to somebody and you speak in love, we have no clue that we're loving on somebody that felt like they ain't had no love in a while. They don't know where to get no love from. We don't know how, when we speaking to somebody sometimes, how relieved they are just to have somebody talking to them. I'm telling you, you just don't have a clue what's on people's mind. And it's not our responsibility to try to read them. But it is our responsibility to try to get God to them. And that's what, because he wants, anyhow, the Bible talks about the brokenhearted in so many different ways. He talks about it in one aspect of the brokenhearted, how sometimes we're broken. He will break us because we need to seek him. And then the other aspect he's talking about, the broken, is the brokenhearted where somebody have been, whether it's abused or divorced or whatever the case may be, the addiction. You know what? I mean, you sit and think about it sometimes. I would guarantee every single person in here is addicted to something. You know? And so it's so easy. It's so wonderful how the Spirit of God changed my perspective on a lot of things, because I used to sit back and go, years ago, many years ago, look at your neighbor and say, years ago. I mean, years ago, I used to sit back and go. I want y'all to say years ago because I don't want you to think it was yesterday. So, I mean, it used to be where I would sit back and go, if he want to stop drinking, why can't he? Well, I sit back and understand. I can't push that cake back. I mean, I'm addicted to some things. Y'all addicted to some things. You know, I know I'm a sweetaholic, and I can't push back the cake and the candy and all that stuff. And I realize sometimes that y'all sitting there smiling or smirking, but it's real. It's real. And I had to sit back and think about how real it is. Not in my case, but my wife was. If y'all ever saw this show called My 600-Pound Life, and I think it's just the nastiest show in the world, but my wife will look at that show, and I sit back, and these people are talking, and you have to understand, these people are not trying to get this size, not for real, and so it's like, why on earth? They ain't smoking, they ain't drinking, it's like, why? They're addicted to food. And it's like, it's real in certain kind. We sometimes minimize certain things. We minimize, and that's how we minimize when we sit back there. It's real. It may be food for you, and it may be alcohol for him. It may be alcohol for him, but it's drugs for him. I mean, we minimize these things. These things, at the end of the day, are still an addiction. It's still something that we need God to come in and intervene. And we got to understand. So there's people out there that's got some things, whether we want to sit back and say he should stop anyway on his own. Well, it ain't our right. We not the creator. We not the savior. So, but our right is to walk down that road and help them with somebody who can help them with that situation. We got to understand, church has got to change in terms of how we look at these things. The church look at these things in a way that's just not positive to society. Well, he should have been doing that. He said he'd been going to church for 6 years. He should have been done with that. Well, I mean, God works his timing and his ways with his people. Who am I? Because he's still working with me on something, you know? And so we got to understand, there's people out there with addictions and with all of these things that need Jesus. Who are we not? We've got to be. I'm saying, as a group, that I knew when I started on these, I was sitting there going, Lord, help me be creative in these lessons, because there ain't going to be a lot of amens. But why? Because we need to be out there witnessing. We need to be out there seeking the lost. It's not a glamorous, it's not a beautiful amen, praise God, thank you. No. It's real that we have to be out there, because people are dying. Scripture began to show us. Jeremiah 1:5 says, "Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you and approved you as my chosen instrument." I want to show you this because I'm telling you, he chose you for somebody. What I mean by that is he chose you to speak to certain people. God had already predestined, and he has already put in your heart that you should be asking them if they know Jesus. He chose you to be driving down this road. You choose to be obedient or not. Everybody in here has already been chosen by God. He chose you as an instrument. Why? Because what you went through in life, what he allowed you to go through in life, because you got to remember, God makes things happen or he allows things to happen. What he allowed you to go through, and you still here, then you should be sharing that with somebody so they could still be here. And so he chose you. Scripture says, "I formed you in the womb, and I knew you and approved you." He didn't just choose his approval. Carolyn, you're approved. You're approved to be able to go over there and talk. You're approved, young lady, to be able to go over there and talk. Rosie, you're approved to be able to go. He chose you as an instrument, approved you as an instrument. He said, before you were born, I consecrate. And then he set you aside for that task. So God has gone through the trouble of getting us prepared to do what we're talking about doing, seeking the lost. So we got a lane. He prepared us for the lane. It's almost like if you can think about Lexus. Lexus has created a vehicle. And they created an SUV, and they created a sports car. They created all these, and they prepared them for certain different things. God prepared you. All of us are different, but he prepared us for certain different places and certain different people. And he chose us for this. And so as born-again believers, we should be tickled to death that he chose us enough. Now we should be able to go do it. He says, "I chose you and consecrated you to myself as my own." He says, "You're my Monique. Now, Monique, I want you going out speaking here. You know, you're my Tracy. I want you over here, Tracy. You're mine. I have appointed you. I chose you and appointed you." He appointed Jeremiah as a prophet over nations. He didn't start with Jeremiah. Then he came to us. He appointed us. We all have a divine assignment with somebody somewhere. I know, and sometimes I miss mine. But my prayer is, "Lord God, show me where you want me to go. I'm going there today. Show me where I should be speaking. I'm going to speak there today. Show me where, Lord, I am." So how do we get to that lane? How do we get down this lane? 1 Corinthians 12:27 tells us, "Now you collectively are Christ's body." He's talking about every single one. He chose every single one of us. God chose every single one of us. He says, "But collectively we're Christ's body, and individually you're members of it." We're the Christ in the world that the people come to see. We are. Some of us are the hands. Some of us are the feet. We're all parts of the body. And God is maneuvering us. It's almost like we're puppets, and he's performing an act, and he's maneuvering us where he wants us to be. We have to answer the question, are we going to be obedient? Lord, am I going to let you use me? You know, I have to think about that. You know, when we sit back and sing the song, "Lord, order my steps," he's been ordering you to witness. You're still asking him to order your steps, but you won't even do the one, you won't even take the first step that he asked you to take. He is telling us, he is asking us, he is begging, pleading with us to take a step, and we won't take it, but we're asking him to give us another step. I can't take you down that road because you haven't gone down this one yet. He is calling all of us to this place, and he says, "Go." So God has appointed and placed you in the church for his own use. Our use is not for ourselves, but for others. If it hadn't been for me, or if it hadn't been somebody praying for me, whether it was mama or grandmama, probably even sister. They say I was so good when I was little that they had to pray for me a lot. I was so good. I'm sure a lot of people was praying for me. I was real good, y'all. Yeah, that's why she beat me, because I was good. And so a lot of people saw how good I was. That's why they were praying for me. I'm sure grandma was up many nights. When I was living with grandma in old age, I probably ran grandma crazy, doing things I shouldn't have been doing, going places I shouldn't have been going. I'm sure mama been up many nights praying for me. So can I be up praying for somebody else? Can I be up not just for mine? No, I got mine. I done prayed. I've been praying since they were born. I've already prayed for their husband. For my grandkids, I already prayed for that. I'm already praying for all of those other things. I done prayed for my daughter, and I'm going to still keep praying for them. I know my daughter ain't going to get married till she's 63. My other one ain't going to get married till she's 65. I done prayed. But I'm talking about praying for somebody else. I mean, there's so many people out here. You just don't know people that you're connected with. We're the body of Christ. We've got to do this. So how do we go down this road? Matthew 9 tells us, as Jesus went throughout all the cities and the villages, you saw this because I want you to see what happens here. How do we do this? How do we do it? I'm going to tell you right now how do we do it. When we begin to look at scripture right here, we got to see what Jesus saw. We need to see what Jesus, we got to see what Jesus, we got to stop looking. And last year we went through this process of scripture talking about and going through over, talking about being spirit-filled. Y'all remember that? We went many weeks on it. I'm not talking about being spirit-filled today. I'm talking about now being spiritually minded. Because once I'm spirit-filled, now I'm led on this road of being spiritually minded. As born-again believers, we have to be spiritually minded. Because one of the things about it is because we're spirit beings now. We're, our spirit is alive to Christ. When we accept Jesus, Lord and Savior, now our spirit is alive to Christ and everything. So we have to be spiritually minded in everything we do. Some people may call you religious-fied or whatever the case may be. No, I'm just spiritually minded. I have the mind of Christ, and so I'm thinking like Christ. And so what do we do on this road? How do we witness to others? We need to see what Jesus sees. Jesus not in the world. He just showed us that we're his body that's in the world now. We're his hands. We're his feet in the world. We're his eyes in the world. We're his lips in the world. We're his ears in the world. We're seeing and hearing and understanding these things that people are going through because we are Jesus in this world. No, we're not Jesus God. We're Jesus. We're his church, the members of his body in this world. And because we're there, we got to see. Look at what Jesus saw. Jesus went throughout all the cities and villages in Galilee, teaching in the synagogue and proclaiming the good news of the gospel and healing every kind of disease. In order to heal some, you got to see some. When we go out there and we're out there witnessing, what are we seeing? When people at the gas station or Walmart, how often do you go through and go, hey, how you doing? And they go, oh, I just, and you say, oh, have a good day, and you just get on. They about, you asked how they doing, and they about to tell you how they doing. But you just ignored them and went on. We're not seeing or hearing what Jesus hear. I mean, at that moment, that's a great opportunity. Well, you know, I've been, that's the perfect opportunity. He said, well, let me introduce you to somebody I know who can help you with that. Let me talk to you about somebody I can. Well, I'm in a hurry, but you know what? Even though I'm in a hurry, I need Jesus to watch my time. Lord, and he'll redeem your minutes right then and there. You ain't going to be late for work. But if you're worried about being late for that work that moment, then you must have been being late for a lot of times. And you know you're on your last leg. If I get late this time, I'm going to be fired. Well, guess what? It wasn't going to happen today. It was going to happen tomorrow because it's just a habit that you got going on. But so you got to understand this. You got to make time. When somebody was, you asked them how they doing. And then they sit back and they send to tell you how they doing. And you just, oh, okay, have a nice day. Have a blessed day is what you said. Now, how can they have a blessed day and you didn't give them nothing? You didn't give them the blessing that they need. The blessing that they need was Jesus. The blessing they needed was Jesus. And you didn't even give it to them. But then you sat there all holified. Have a blessed day. I mean, dude, you got to talk to people. You walk up to people, saved, unsaved. No, everybody know the cliche. How you doing? Oh, I'm blessed and highly favored. But if you're so blessed and highly favored, how come you're not sharing that blessing of Jesus with somebody? I mean, because that's the blessing that's in there. So Jesus, he went and he saw these diseases and every kind of sickness, his words and his works reflecting his messiahship. Watch this in the 36th verse. When he saw the crowd, I guarantee you today, tomorrow, and the next day, you're going to see the crowd. When he saw the crowd, what did he see? He was moved with compassion. See, the problem with born-again believers today, we're not seeing. I was one of them. I was just hardcore in so much. You know, Kendall tell you, when Kendall had her baby, I went to the hospital. I told her, get up out that bed, let's go. What you? I just had a baby, ain't you? Hey, I said in the olden days, they plopped them out and kept on walking. What you talking about, Thomas? No. I had little compassion for people back then when I used to see. And it took God to change me and understanding this. And now I just have to watch me, because now I have to watch, making sure I ain't overcompensating with too much compassion. Jesus saw these people. The Bible says he was moved with compassion. There's people that you're passing through right now you know are struggling. We're not asking that you give them any money. We're not asking that you give them anything. I'm not saying come out your pocket. I'm saying just give them Jesus. Because once you give them Jesus, Jesus will lead somebody to them that'll give them the money that they need, if that's what it is. He know you ain't got it. He ain't asked you to give it then if you ain't got it. He just asked you to give them him. We got to learn how to be moved with compassion and understand that if that person die tomorrow, they might be going to hell. If that person, you got a family member right now that you might even be mad at, but you know in your heart, if that person die today, he might be going to hell. Because he don't know Jesus. No, this ain't the church of inclusion. We ain't all. The Bible speaks of hell. The Bible speaks of heaven. We ain't going to talk a whole lot about hell because that ain't where we going, and we just talk about it and celebrate where we're going. But there are people dying going there. And so when are we going to be the ones? You got to understand, he is calling us to do this. He was moved with compassion and pity for them because they were dispirited and distressed. Y'all, we see them every day. When are we going to be obedient and go down this lane? This is the right lane, and God wants us to stay in this lane. When are we going to go down this one road lane and seek the lost? You know, I don't even know if we should even call it seeking the lost, because they right there. You ain't got to go looking for them. They right there. It should just be attend the lost, because we're with them every day. We shouldn't even have to call it seeking. We're with them right now. When are we going to attend the lost? This is what God is calling us to. I know the churches don't want to hear this today. It's not being preached. You know, it's funny because I Googled 2 days ago. We started this portion of the message last week. 2 days ago, I was just sitting there thought about it. I said, how many messages? You can't find a whole lot of messages on seeking the lost. You can't. And I thought about that. And selfishly, I went, Creflo Dollar, seeking the lost. I just want to see if he teaches. Joyce Meyer, seeking the lost. I'm sitting there going, wow, some of these people that we look at, these, they could be speaking to 2,000, 3,000, 8,000, 10,000, 15,000 people about seeking the lost. We can't be so concerned with them in terms of what they ain't doing, but what I'm just saying is that it's not the church, we're not doing it. It could be put out in mass production. You know, it's amazing that on one Sunday, man, God can send out probably 100,000 people to seek the lost. Guess how many people can get saved on that Sunday? What we waiting on God to get up there with a microphone and say, okay, go. He already said it. What are we really waiting on? As a church, we got to do what he called us to do. Jesus saw a great need. He saw people that was lost. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful. He saw it. I began going through. Jesus saw lost people that was distressed. I want to show you here in Ephesians 2. No, I'm not going to stay there. I'm going to go on past that. Jesus, we got to see what Jesus saw. Keep going. We got to feel what as Jesus felt. Matthew 9, he says here, he was moved. He saw, he felt. We see, we keep going. Remember, we see, we keep going. And if you're honest with yourself, then you ain't got to raise your hand. How many like you raise their hand that can say, that could raise your hand, that I knew somebody was, they had a need, but I just kept going because I had a need. Well, I had a need to get to work, or I had a need to move on, or they ain't look like you, they ain't act like you. We got to feel what Jesus feels. Once we see what he sees, now we got to feel. You know, we got to see and we got to feel like Jesus. If we're going to go down this road, now we got to feel. We got to be compassionate. You know, we got to feel this. We got to, he was moved. We got to be moved. People are in pain, and when people are in pain, they see, you know, if you're in pain right now, you get you a painkiller, right? And there's many painkillers out there. People are using everything they can to mask the pain, to stop the pain. People are using everything, alcohol to stop the pain, drugs to stop the pain, sex to stop the pain, everything they can to stop the pain. But we got the painkiller. We got to be the one giving it to them. We the one got the painkiller. He'll kill every pain that's going on in them. Everything that's hurting. He will heal all of that, stop all of that pain. We got the pain. They searching for it. How do I know they searching? Just look around. The people ain't just trying to get high. Just got that. Now they trying to get something else. They searching for something. They hurting. And they, nope, this drug didn't stop it. Let me try this one. This alcohol didn't stop it. They trying it. And at the end of the day, guess what? The pain's still going to come back. We got something that'll help them stop that pain, ease that pain, and the pain won't come back. But we won't. We got to feel how he felt, how Jesus felt. We got to understand. I mean, as you think about it, all of these unhealthy coping mechanisms that the world uses, the only mechanism that they need is Jesus. But there's so many unhealthy coping mechanisms. You probably have tried some. You know, I noticed at times, it was times when, you know, Tylenol bottle says, you know, take two pills every so many hours or whatever the case may be. It was times when I would have a headache that was so excruciating for whatever reason, and I would probably take about six. And Melissa would sit back and she'd be like, you're taking too many. I'm sitting there going, it ain't going to kill me. You know, it'll be strong enough. And then she said, well, you're taking too much. And I'd be like, well, I done put on some weight, so I need more to help me. I said, that was for a child, and a small child. I said, I'm a big man. So I was trying to do everything I can until I realized, wait a minute, I can keep taking these Tylenol. I got a sinus headache. I'm taking the wrong thing anyway. I couldn't get rid of the headache because it was the wrong thing. I needed something to relieve my sinuses because I had a sinus headache, and I'm sitting here trying to take something else. And it's just like them. They're taking something to relieve some pain, and the pain won't go nowhere because they're taking the wrong thing. But we won't write the prescription because the prescription is Jesus. We won't give them the prescription that they need. But they're taking it, and they're going to keep taking it. And I can keep taking that Tylenol if I want the ibuprofen or whatever I take. I can keep taking it all day long, and it ain't going to stop nothing. Why? Because I'm taking the wrong thing. They can keep drinking that alcohol, but it ain't going to stop the pain. It'll stop it for that moment, but guess what? When they sober back up, it's back right there. So we got to give them the right thing. The Bible tells us. 1 Peter says it. But in your heart, set Christ apart as holy, acknowledging him, giving him first place in your lives as Lord. Here's where we have to get. Because sometimes, you say, now, well, how does this fit in here? Sometimes, as born-again believers, we accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. And the reason we're not walking down this road or driving down the right road in the right lane is because we haven't given him our first. Our first. See, the first thing that we have to do is we got to understand everything. Everything belongs to the Lord. Everything with us. Lord, here I am. The Bible says that we should love the Lord thy God with all the heart, all the mind, all the soul. Lord, I'm going to give you everything that's within me. Here I am. I'm just going to surrender. And if I do, what happens is that I'm willing to obey everything that he's called me to. See, I haven't given him everything if I'm not willing to obey. We was kind of talking about that in men's class this morning. Am I willing, you know, as Christians, am I willing to stop doing this to please God, or am I going to keep making an excuse that this is okay? Am I willing? Am I willing to give up how I feel about witnessing to people? Am I willing to give up my fears in sharing the gospel? Am I willing to give up those things because I love him first? Am I willing to do that? Scripture tells me, hey, giving him first place. When I give him first place, I am completely surrendering everything to him. Not my fears anymore, not my concerns anymore. I'm going to do what you want me to do, Lord. But as Christians, sometimes we don't get to that place. We got to get to that place. That's why I truly believe, because you got churches filled, then why are they not seeking the lost? Because, you know, we've taken some things back from God. But when I give God everything, when I give him everything, now I'm willing to do everything that he wants me to do. I'm willing to sacrifice my time. I'm willing to sacrifice this. I'm willing to sacrifice because I am giving him everything. I'm loving him with everything I have. all my heart, all my mind, every fiber in my body, I'm giving it to him. Always be ready to give a logical defense. How many times do you shy away from sharing the gospel? Answer that to yourself. If you're in a crowd and or on the job and you're afraid to say certain things because you don't want things to go a certain way, as born-again believers, we can't be afraid of that no more. We got to be ready to stand firm and say, no, I'm a child of God. I'm a Christian. You know, I had a conversation with a couple of individuals last week, and they were sitting there. Something came out. One of the pastors had did something. And the first thing they said back, and that's why I don't go to church. And my polite answer was, that's not the reason that you don't go to church. I said, that's the excuse why you don't go to church. I said, because everybody are imperfect people. And I said, but here's the other side of it. There are some great churches. I said, you go to the doctor, even though there's some quack doctors out there, don't you? You go to the dentist, and there's some bad dentists out there. You got all of these things, but it's church that we'll pull away from. All of these other things. I said, no. And I was just real polite, and I told him, and I wasn't trying to be ugly, and I wasn't trying to be snotty. And I told him point blank, I said, no, that's the excuse that you use. You choose not to go to church for whatever reason. You choose not to go to church. I said, but it's not because people are doing things bad. I ain't perfect. I'm going to do some things. I'm gonna fall short somewhere. You know, I ain't perfect. But I left him with this. I said, and if you're looking for a perfect church, you'll never find it, because there's always going to be an imperfect person there, you. And that's where we are. We are sitting back in a time where we have to seek the lost and we have to speak truth. Now, sometimes do we need to be quiet? Let the Holy Spirit lead you. But we have to stand up for God's word. I mean, we're in a time right now where Christians are getting boo-booed on. Everybody's got rights but Christians. You know, you got a right. You know, gays got the right. This one got the right. That one got the right. I mean, everybody got rights. But being a Christian, you know, you ain't got a right to believe the way you believe. You're a bigot.
Really?
I don't have the right. But they got the right to identify as. That don't make them weird. But me believing in that makes me a bigot and make me... Christians don't have rights. It's time for us to stand up. It's time for us to speak. I ain't saying go lose your job, but I'm saying it's time to stand firm and not being shying away from what God has called us to do. We have to share the gospel. If it's only because people are dying without knowing Christ, do what God has called us to do. I'm going to leave you with this. I'm not even going to go there. I'm going to go to this scripture here. Matthew 25. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and majesty and all the angels with him, he will sit on the throne of his glory, and all the nations will be gathered before him for judgment, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd separates his sheep from the goat. The Bible is talking about how God will begin separating. I don't know if she caught up because I went where? To another place. She's there with me. The Bible says that, and he will put the sheep on the right in place of honor and the goats on the left in place of rejection. Then the king will say to all those on the right, come, you blessed of my father, you favored of God, appointed to eternal salvation. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you in the foundation of this world. The Bible tells us that he's going to separate us at the judgment. And for those that have accepted him, that he's going to put on the right, and then he's going to put all those on the left. And then he's going to take those on the right, and he's going to show them what he's prepared and what he prepared in terms of the kingdom of heaven. And then on the left, he's going to show all of those who have not accepted him. My question to you is, if we was conscious when he did that, when we look over and when we see somebody that God put in our place for us to witness to him or to her, what will we think? Are they in hell because I didn't do what God has called me to do? Or are they in hell because they chose not to do? See, one of the things I don't want is I don't want somebody going to hell because I didn't do what God called me to do. I want it to be because they chose not to do. I don't want it to be because I didn't ever take the word to them, or I didn't ever say a prayer with them, or I didn't ever share the word with them. But God is calling us, and he's calling every single person. If you love them,
you'll share Jesus with them. Stand to your feet. The altar is open for anyone that wants to accept Jesus, Lord and Savior. For anybody that wants to be restored in right fellowship. The altar is open. For anybody that wants prayer, you may come to the altar. Today is a day when God is calling us to accept his call and seek the lost. We got to see what Jesus see, and we got to feel what Jesus feel. And then we need to speak what Jesus spoke. Amen. Father, I come before you right now in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you forgive me of my life of sin. But today, Lord, I come to accept this free gift of salvation. I come for this new life in Christ. Father, your word says to be born again. I
accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I turn from my ways and turn to His. If you prayed that simple prayer, you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you are a born-again believer. Please see me or one of the leaders so that we can assist you. There may be one in the midst that has already accepted Jesus, but you've turned away. You want to be restored in right fellowship. Pray this simple prayer. Heavenly Father, I pray before you right now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, I ask that you forgive me. Forgive me for turning away. Forgive me for trusting in myself. Forgive me for doing my own thing. But today I ask and pray that you restore me. Restore me in right fellowship. Lord, I surrender my will, my way, and my life to you this day. If there's one that prayed that simple prayer, you've been restored in right fellowship, please see one of me or our leaders so that we can assist you down this journey. There may be one that just wants prayer, one that wants to be part of the family, one just seeking guidance. Father, we just thank you for each and every soul that's here before you today. Father, we thank you for the word that you've given us, and we thank you that it's your Spirit ministering behind every spoken and every written word that we receive this day. Father, I pray that each life has been touched by this. Father, you speak to our hearts and guide us and lead us. You know what's in our hearts and what's on our minds. Lord, you know what we need. So, Father, for those seeking salvation, those seeking restoration, those seeking a family, a church family, Father, those that have individual prayers seeking guidance from you, I lift each and every soul before you today, and I lift each prayer before you this day. Lord, we come praying without doubt and thanking you for all that you've done and thanking you for what you're preparing to do. Move in our lives. Move in this church. Doing things that you've called us to do. Being where you want us to be. Father, continue to build us so that we can see what you see. So that we can feel what you feel. So that we can be in a place bold enough to speak what you speak. We look to you this day and we thank you, giving you all glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. I'm not going to hold you long as we share our fellowship Sunday today. As I love fellowship Sunday and I love those as we continue to just pour out with bread in this place in our fellowship, our Unity Sunday. As we prepare to fellowship in the back, as we dismiss our bless the meal and I pray that everybody sit with someone new, sit with someone different, and continue to fellowship and embrace all of those that's here today. I don't think that we have any announcements. We do. Thursday, you know, as we always do, as we come into a new month, let me see exactly how it comes. We always go into a new month in prayer, in our midnight prayer. And as we have it coming up now, it is... Well, it's Thursday, our Thirsty Thursday. And so we'll be out praying. Thursday we'll go into it at 11:59 Thursday night. We'll pray into Friday morning, our new month, as we have our midnight prayer. And then Friday we'll be here at 5:30 praying, as we always do at the first of the month. But anyway, we'll continue to be lifting up our causes. We'll be continuing lifting up our families and anything else that comes up that way. You know, I'm really impressed in how God has really moved with us and how we've been praying more and more. Over about the last 5 years, we've just increased how much we pray, And that's the key, guys, to continue praying. You know, we've seen prayer change things in so many aspects. We've seen prayer for healing, touch. We've seen prayer for restoration, restore. We've seen prayer just move in a mighty way. I can't say enough. We have to consistently be a praying ministry. Even as Jesus said, and pray for the workers. We need to be praying for those too, praying for more people to come in that work, to work and be a part of what we're doing so that we can continue seeking the lost and sharing all of that. So, yes, ma'am. Thank you. All right. So we ask, so you join in and where, you know, get in where you fit in. You know, we talk about sick and lost. Just the ministry at the hospital is an easy avenue of seeking the lost when we're sharing something with somebody, because you know you have to fill a need physically a lot of times before you can spiritually. And so even that at the hospital, that's an easy way to pray for someone, and that leads into that conversation. We have to always be looking for ways so that we can seek people out and go with that. We'll be working on resurrection. So for those kids that want to be a part, even adults, and adults that want to be a part, you ain't too young to be a part of it. Wednesday night, the kids will be practicing for resurrection. I know we have a little ways before that, but we want to make sure we're prepared. We want to make sure that we're embracing that. And so with that, so let's continue to lift up one another in prayer. As unity, God's called us to be one in body, one in spirit, unified together. Let's continue encouraging one another, praying for one another, and being there to support one another. Here at Fountain of Life, we're more than just a church. We are family, and we got to act like it. Stand to your feet as we prepare to dismiss. Yes, sir. So see, that gives you another opportunity when you share. You ain't got to tell them I drive you to church. You ain't tell them I send somebody to pick you up. So we help you out on that one. There's a lot of ways. So seek the lost. They ain't got no ride. You ain't got to go get them. We'll get them. So let's make sure we are doing that. People out there that might need a ride. So let's make sure that we can do what we can do so that we can get that. If there's anything else, I want to thank everybody for being here today. You could have been elsewhere, but you were not. You could have been anywhere else, but you were not. You was here fellowshipping and worshiping with us. I thank all of those that are streaming and welcome you in as well as we continue to fellowship in person. Here at Fountain Life, we're more than just a church. We're family, and we come to that to embrace one another, to motivate one another, to be there to support one another. Father, as we come before you today, we thank you. We thank you for this family. I lift this family to you today, Lord God. I ask that you bless us and keep us, and that your face shine upon us. Father, as we prepare to give, your word says give, and it will be given. Pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Father, we thank you for every gift that we receive this day, praying that we are consistently, continually being faithful stewards and using, Lord God, these for the resources that you've already predestined us for. Father, we ask that you bless the meal at the meal table, bless the conversation at the table. Father, we ask that you bless it and strengthen us as we continue to come together as one. Help us to fellowship and please you in the midst of our fellowship. We give you glory and praise your name. Father, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation in our hearts are acceptable to you in everything we do and wherever we are. And it's in Jesus' name.